I should not have watched that. Thank God for our armed forces and the men of this church that served. As I was getting ready for church this morning, I was trying to name them all, and I know I've forgotten some, but praise God, because we had quite a few in our church that have served in the armed services. We still have John Riley's son that is serving, and will soon be moving to North Carolina, is it, John? By August, he'll be moving there with his family. And I know some of you all have friends that have children in the services. We need to pray for them, because we live in a country free because of them. And praise God for them. Welcome this morning on Memorial Day. What a beautiful morning it is to celebrate our veterans. We have a trustee meeting this Thursday by Zoom. So if you're a trustee, you know where you need to be. Also keep in mind that Saturday, June the 19th is the men's fellowship at Southern Bell. So men, please mark their calendars and join that at 10 o'clock. Also, we have Bible studies going on. This week, we won't have a Bible study on Tuesday. As most of you know, Beth Wagner passed away Friday morning at her home, and her funeral is, on Tuesday from 3 to 9, but her actual celebration will be at 6:30 at the funeral home right across from Renwick on Renwick Road, that new one that was built right across from the golf course and that restaurant there, that funeral home there. So please remember that family in your prayers as well. Have I forgotten any announcements that I need to make at this time? We are knitting and crocheting on Wednesdays and Saturdays here at the church at 10 o'clock. So if you would like to join us, we're not working on anything special right now. We're just doing our own projects. And if we get stuck, then we have a couple of people that can give us some help. So if you would like. Also, save the date for Sunday, June the 27th. We have information coming out on that. That is a Welcome Back Sunday. We're going to be sending out invitations, and we're going to have a signing party, because we're going to sign the invitations to send out. So we're going to be doing that shortly. But just mark that, Sunday, June 27th. Bring a friend. Bring your neighbor. Bring your brother, bring your sister, bring your husband, bring your wife,
bring yourself,
bring your grandchildren. So if there's no further announcements, I'm going to turn it over to Pastor for our opening prayer.
Well, thank you, dear. What a glorious day. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for the opportunity today to serve you, to worship you, and to honor those, our God, who paid the ultimate sacrifice for the freedom of our nation. Father, we know that as we go about this day, many memories come to our mind. And God, for that I thank you. I thank you that the power of your Holy Spirit being with us today will bring forth anointing in this service upon our ears and our hearts and our minds to receive a message of memorial. God, we pray today that you would just open our hearts to your will. And God, as we honor our veterans, actually honor those who have died in all the conflicts across this world, Lord, we also pray for their families. We know, God, how difficult it is to traverse that valley of the shadow of death. But we also know that we walk through it. Father, we pray especially today for Beth Wagner's family. God, we ask you to comfort her. Comfort the daughter, the son, God, to bless the family, the grandchildren, the nieces and the nephews. God, as we pray together today, we ask especially a blessing upon our nation. God, we ask that you would bring to us the sense and sensibilities of Christ himself. And God, that we would be one nation under you, that we would find the unity of faith and the stature and the measure of Christ in this land, and God, that once again we would rise above all the clamor of the world just to be able to give you praise, glory, and honor. Our Father, today we give you praise. Thank you for this service and ask your blessing in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Joshua. Now, y'all might not be able to find that in your book, but that's in mine. Joshua, chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. When the whole nation had finished crossing the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, "Choose 12 men from among the people, one from each tribe, and tell them to go take up 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan, right where the priests are standing, and carry them over with you and put them down in the place where you stay tonight." So Joshua called together the 12 men he had appointed from the Israelites, one from each tribe, and said to them, "Go over before the ark of the Lord your God and to the middle of the Jordan, each of you, and take up a stone on his shoulder, according to the number of the tribes of the Israelites, to serve as a sign among you in the future when your children ask, 'What do these stones mean?' Tell them that the flow of the Jordan was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord when it crossed the Jordan. Waters of the Jordan were cut off. These stones are to be a memorial to the people of Israel forever." So the Israelites did as Joshua commanded them. They took 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan according to the number of the tribes of the Israelites, as the Lord had told Joshua, and they carried them over with them to their camp, where they put them down. Joshua set up the 12 stones that had been in the middle of the Jordan at the spot where the priest who had carried the Ark of the Covenant had stood. And there it is to this day. Would you stand with me, please, as we sing our opening hymn, page 416. You notice Jan didn't holler at me? I changed the order. She changed the order. Page 416. Let's stand together.
Oh,
Do we have any prayer requests today? Anything you'd like to pray for specifically now? Your mom? Okay. Any others? Let's go to prayer. Father, it is a time that we come together to pray. It is a time that we lift up the needs of our congregation. It is the time of prayer. Father, I look at what the time of prayer truly means. And God, as I think about this time, not the noon prayer, not my private prayer, but this time, where we all gather together to agree, to believe together for the meeting of needs. Father, Jan's mom, she needs a touch of your great hand upon her body, upon her mind. Father, I'm going to be talking today, hopefully, about memory. This thing that we call dementia, memory loss, Alzheimer's, all of those things rolled into one, is a debilitating disease. But our God, you are the God that healeth all of our diseases. Not just cancer. Not just a broken toenail. Not just a headache. But you heal them all. And God, as we pray together today, I want to give you honor because our God, we still live in a land that is still free. And God, that we who enjoy that, Lord, the generation that's in this room today knows beyond a shadow of a doubt the cost that has been paid. Father, I pray for the younger generation that they begin to know what the cost of freedom really is. And I thank you, Father, for the freedom of sin. I thank you that you meet every need here, every unspoken request be met according to the riches that you have in glory. Our God, today we pray these things in Jesus' name, believing not only that you hear us, but that you respond to us, and that, God, you do answer our prayers. Father, today we thank you for that in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Page 418 is our next song.
Of the fruit.
Praise the Lord. I know you're asking, what sense is having a bulletin? Gave Bob something to do this week. Well, about 7:30, I got the urge that I've been working on some things with copyright and all the other kind of stuff, so hope it works out. Today's message. The title thereof, hopefully you will understand it, it's Hopeful Memory. But before that, I'd like to share a story that I read this week. It's short, relatively, shorter than my sermon. Another Memorial Day, cold and dreary. The worst holiday weekend I could remember. And worst of all, my husband and I still lived in this isolated town of nearly 1,000 people in the Sierra Nevada in northeastern California. A town where I felt like I didn't belong. You'll get used to it, my husband said when he persuaded me to move from Sacramento, where our Flatlander families lived 3 hours away. There'll be no smog, no traffic jams, he said. And nothing to do, I finished. Well, we'll be cut off. Where will I work? You can work in my office. That was a mistake. You can work in my office. It says, Reno and shopping malls are only an hour away. The scenery's spectacular. Maybe, I said, as long as it's only temporary. But as months went by, then years, temporary was looking pretty permanent to me. And even though the townspeople had made us feel more than welcome and the children seemed content, I never thought of this place as home. Will I ever feel as if I belong here, I wondered. The rain had stopped, and I felt a sudden urge to get out of the house to escape, so I decided to go for a walk. 3 blocks away, I paused at the gate of the local cemetery. It was on a hill overlooking the town. It somehow seemed to beckon me. I hurried through the gate and climbed the hill, and the wind stung my cheeks as I walked among the plots, looking at the graves, some simple markers, some elaborate stones. But what had drawn me here? Then I noticed Pauline, an energetic 70-year-old from our church. She was leaning over the grave, straightening the flowers that had blown over, fitting the container back into the white rock. Pauline could outwalk any of us younger women in the church and go on to organize a church dinner. She was a challenger, too. She always asked the unanswerable questions in Sunday school. But today, as I watched her, she brushed her cheek and stood back, staring down at the polished granite tombstone. Hi, Pauline, I said, moving towards her. She didn't say a word, threw her arms out and hugged me. Not the hello Sunday morning hug, but a hug like she needed someone to understand. She looked at me and she said, there are so many memories here. Tell me some of them, I said. For the next hour, we walked through the rows of the headstones and Pauline would recall many of the people whose names appeared. And then she pointed out a tiny headstone for a baby who had been stillborn to a mother we both knew. Nearby was the grave of another woman at church, Emma. I had visited Emma a lot. Her blue and white gingerbread fringed home had always smelled of just baked bread. Smells like my grandma's house. We never parted without taking something home to eat and her challenging us to get in the Bible. Then Robert DeMartini drove up with his pickup and his two boys. He had flowers for his parents' grave. I had sung at his mother's funeral several years ago. It was the hardest solo I'd ever done for the mother of a friend. At the far side of the cemetery was a peculiar view of the valley. Manicured green fields, beautifully stretched out beneath the towering mountain peaks, covered with snow. Even on that day, it was breathtaking. Pauline pointed out toward two tall markers on the edge of the hill. They seemed to be standing watch over our town, she said. I stared at the two tall markers, thinking about the families who had put them there. And then my gaze drifted directly in between them. To my surprise, I found myself looking down at a two-story house. My house. I'd never realized it was visible from this vantage point. How peculiar, I thought, just juxtaposed with these two, with those who lived and died in Loyalton. As I stood there, God's Spirit touched me with a quiet new understanding. You will love, you will be loved right here where I planted you. In a flash, I thought of them all. The people who had bought us meals, that helped us clean our house when it flooded. The neighbors who babysat when our child was sick. The neighbor who started our car twice. Why had it taken so long for me to see it? When I first came to this small town, I feared I'd be isolated, cut off. Instead, I had all these friends, all this love. Isn't that what belonging is about? I turned and looked in the panorama of the cemetery, filled with flowers brought in for this special day. Almost every grave was decorated. Someday mine will be too. The sun broke through the threatening clouds, sending a lovely light around us. Pauline looked at me and said, "Ready to head for home?" She asked, and I said, "Oh, Pauline, I am home." It doesn't mean anything to y'all, but just me. You know why it means so much to me? We are home. Everybody in this room knows how much I always wanted to go back home. How can you go back to where you already are? When I read that story, I bawled like a baby. Then I found God leading me to Joshua chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. That's the beginning of my sermon. This is my sermon. In the later years of life, in the great 19th century, American philosopher Ralph Waldo Emerson, y'all ever heard of him? Ralph Waldo Emerson suffered from an increasingly faulty memory. When things would slip his mind, he complained about his naughty memory. Sometimes Emerson would forget the simplest things, and in order to not appear like he'd lost his mind, he would say, he couldn't think of the word plow. He would say, "You know that implement that cultivates the ground." Well, he was at the funeral of his great friend and longtime friend. What was his name? Oh, that's right. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. And after the service, he commented to someone standing next to him, "That gentleman had a sweet spirit, but I tell you, I cannot for the life of me remember his name." I had someone say to me just this week, "It's humiliating to have your memory go bad. It's unfortunate, inconvenient, and at times embarrassing not to remember." Yet without a doubt, For some people, the failure of memory is largely unavoidable. That's not always the case, though. Sometimes we're forgetful because we neglect that which has gone on before us and become inattentive to those things that preceded us. We center all of our attention only on our own time and our own place. We act as though the present is all that matters. The past is some shabby thing that can be safely cast off and thrown away. That's why this video was so important to me. I know it was to John, but it was to me. If you watch that video closely, the officer who presented the flag a few frames later was the same one who was leaning on the casket crying. Here we are, it's Memorial Day. Actually, it's the day before. No, actually, this is Memorial Day. They celebrate it on Monday, but it's the 30th of May. I remember 30th of May, whenever it fell, my dad was in Indianapolis. You see, on this occasion, we're called to remember and respect those who have died, those whose days are gone. It's no surprise to us that many people don't reflect much upon the past during this holiday any more than they do any other day. In our age of ever-accelerating change, we don't tend to look at the past and find our wisdom. We view it as a has-been. We look at it as something that just happened. It's irrelevant now. The ancient are not our models. We place little value on the traditions inherited from them. And so, when Memorial Day rolls around, our thoughts don't automatically turn to the past and to the departed. Most people appreciate Memorial Day because it's an extra day off of work, paid usually. Enjoy your day off. Enjoy it with all your might, but sometime during that day, please take a minute. If you can't sacrifice 60 seconds to remember what those who paid the ultimate price sacrificed for you, then I say shame. This holiday is not expressly religious. I want you to understand that. I'm not here to worship the dead. I'm not here to do that. I am here to describe to you what memorial is. This holiday can serve to promote the value elevated through scriptures. That whatever the importance of remembrance is, we now want to remember it. You see, failure of memory is not just something which leads to personal inconvenience or social embarrassment. It's a spiritual danger. Joshua, the river is backed up. The priests are still standing out in the middle of the river. Backed up behind them is the Jordan River, getting higher and higher and stronger and stronger. And 2.5 million Israelites walk across the river on dry ground, and they would have never been able to do that if the priest hadn't first stepped into the water, not on dry ground, into the water. What were they doing in the water? They were burying the Ark of the Covenant. So Joshua says, go out where they're standing, and each of you men get a rock. Now, some of you would have probably come back with a rock like that. But if you heard Joshua's explanation of what they're to get, on your shoulder, a rock so big you have to probably get help to get it up. You see, a quick scanning of biblical documents makes apparent the importance of remembering. Throughout Scripture, we find reference to memorials and monuments, memorial feasts, ritual, repeated stories over and over and over again to reinforce the sacred. In various ways, the great saving acts of God were rehearsed and represented so that you wouldn't forget what God has done. That's what the memorial was about. That's why these pile of stones. Oh, by the way, does anybody know the name of the pile of stones? Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor. You see, that is what an Ebenezer is. It's a memorial. I'll never forget one of the memorial services we did for Cedar Lake. I put before each of the folks who had passed a rock. And I wanted Patty, the girl that works out there, to take the rocks that were in front of each one of those people's pictures and glue them together and just make a little Ebenezer. Just a little one. We don't have to go get boulders. Just a little one, and set it on the counter by the pictures and say, gee, that's an Ebenezer. I don't know if it ever happened or not. But the thing is, we're to remember what God has done. The Old Testament text, which we heard earlier, of Joshua, stands is one example of this practice. The biblical narrative which leads up to the text of the Israelites' long-awaited entry into the promised land. After 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, wouldn't you want to put a marker someplace to say, we made it? That's the reason I read you this story. It's a marker for me. Marker. It's a memorial. When the priests who were carrying the Ark of the Covenant began to place their feet in the river, the water ceased flowing. Praise God. The Egyptians, it's an exact replica of what took place when they crossed the Red Sea. Exactly. The pounding insistence, the call to remember, is repeated throughout Scripture. Remember that God called your father Abraham in his old age and promised him children. Remember that the bondage in foreign land, you were freed by divine power. Remember that God brought Israel to greatness, though it was the weakest of all nations. Remember the commands of the Lord. The psalmist summed it up this way in Psalm 105:5. Remember his marvelous works that he hath done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. Remember him. We're at this Memorial Day service, thinking about our loved ones and those who paid the ultimate price for our freedom. Think about the one who paid the ultimate price for your freedom from sin. That would be Jesus. I hope I don't have to remind you of that. Those who forgot the past fell into thanklessness. It's unlikely that we will do any better. If we forget the value of our heritage and the source of our blessing, it will become very easy for us to take for granted all that we have and that we are. It will be very easy for us to begin believing that we can make our own way without God. With the blindness of pride, we will very likely begin trusting in our own wisdom, our own power, rather than relying on the guidance and the might of our Maker. Then, in our wrong-headed self-confidence, we will lose our way. For this reason, it is crucial that we remember. Y'all have heard this story. Every Memorial Day, it wasn't called Memorial Day when I grew up, it was Decoration Day. My aunt would get me up at 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning. We'd go to every cemetery in the city of Cincinnati. I said, Aunt Charlotte, do we have people that we know in all these cemeteries? Yes, son, we do. There, 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 there. Every Memorial Day. I was kind of at her beck and call because I was being babysat by her because my dad was gone. And my mom did anything Aunt Charlotte said. So there we were, the three of us. Me sitting in the back seat of a Packard. But it taught me something very important. Never forget that. Never forget. I suppose every culture and every country has its memorials. The best memorials lift our sights up. You go to the Lincoln Monument. You go to the Washington thing, that big just thing that sticks up there in Washington. You know that thing. The plow. No, the Washington. You see, you go to those places and you get inspired. I do. We were at ORU one time and they had the walk through the Bible there. And you started out in Genesis and you saw the serpent and all that, and you walked through and you ended up in the ark, and the ark pitched and wailed. Boy, it was dramatic to see that and to feel that. You're standing in the ark and the ark's going, ooh, and you're going, whoa, wait a minute. I want to go down to Kentucky and see the Noah's Ark. I want to go there. Someday. I'm not in a hurry. And I promise you, I'll come back. Sometimes dwelling in the past, here's where y'all start throwing things at me. Dwelling in the past means of escaping the problems of the present and disrupting the prospects of the future. Living in the past. Have any of you ever lived in the past? Well, if you do, it means you're escaping the problems of the present and you're ruining the prospects of the future. I suppose we all know people who seem to continually walk about and tell you how great things used to be. Life was simpler, friends were closer, motives were purer, morals were higher. On and on and on it goes, right? You've heard those words come out of my mouth. For some people, the golden age was the 20s. For others of us, it was the 60s. Some of us, it may have been the 50s or the 40s. I really liked the 40s, although I didn't live in it. I just liked the music that came out of it. No matter what age it was, no matter what your favorite era is, the problem with looking back to the golden age is that we distort the past and we come to believe. Now, I want to turn the page because I don't want this to be missed. We come to believe that the best days are already gone behind us and the future ain't worth a squat. Hello? Everything that follows is anticlimactic. Consequently, some people who are disappointed with the present and distressed over the future tend to live in the past. This story was about someone who tried to live in the past. You see, their memories are highly important to them. But they don't have any hopeful memories. You see, hopeful memory does not drag us into the past and lock us there. Hopeful memory does not tell us the best of life is already gone. When I turned 60 years old, I thought life was over with. What a stupid guy I was. I thought it was all over with. You see? Hopeful memories does not let us believe that life is already over and we're just waiting for the end. You see, the thing of it is, it thrusts us into the future. If we look at the past with hopeful memories, it will catapult us into the future because we trust in the God that we serve. You see, God's people, he told them to remember. The prophets told them to remember the works of the Lord he has done in the past. This was to prepare them for the future. Remember when God did this. Remember in 1990 here in Plainfield when God spared this. You realize this building could have been gone. You say, oh, it wasn't in the path of the storm. You ain't never been in a storm, man. The storm's got minds of their own. You understand? You see, they're not called to remember the past for its own sake. The practice was not self-indulgent diversion. Rather, they were to remember the wonders of the past so that their lives could be open to the greater wonders of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. For I received the Lord, which that I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus on the night he was betrayed. You want to talk about a memorial? There it is, the bread and the cup. It's a memorial. It's a memorial to who? To what? It's a memorial to the future from the past. Jesus said what? I'll not drink this with you again until I drink it anew in the kingdom. That gives me hope. That gives me excitement in my step. Boy, I'll tell you, I need excitement in my step. The Lord's Supper is a hopeful memorial. It doesn't falsely glorify the past. When we partake of the bread and the cup, we remember the body and we remember the blood of Jesus. Yet the Lord's Supper, we see even more than that. We see the promise. This was pre-crucifixion. This was pre-burial. This was pre-death. Yet, 3 days later, what took place? The promise came to life again. And the promise lives today, and every time we do communion, we build that Ebenezer. With Memorial Day upon us, it's proper to think of the past and of those who've gone from this world. But for those who are Christians, let me start that sentence again. But for those of us who are Christians, this is not exclusively an exercise in looking behind and dwelling upon what has been. For we believe that more wondrous things are yet to come for those people who died in faith. We live considering the resurrection. We believe that death will not be the end. In 1969, Clarence Jordan. Does anybody know who Clarence Jordan is? Probably never heard of him before. But he's the author of the Cotton Patch Gospel. and Koinonia Farms in Georgia. Now, I know this probably doesn't mean a lot to you, but I would like a lot of our young people to hear this story. Koinonia Farms was an interracial community in Georgia in the 60s. I lived through that time. I know what this means. His work faced vicious opposition from many of the religious men in his area. During the 50s and the 60s, when he was trying to get this thing going, in the 50s and 60s, an interracial farm was not even thought of. In fact, when Jordan died, the local undertakers and clergy were of no help. Jordan was buried in a plain cedar box on the hillside of his own farm. Millard Fuller, you may or may not have ever heard that name before, but he is the one who began Habitat for Humanity. Millard Fuller officiated at his funeral. Just after the casket was lowered into the ground and the grave was being filled in, an unexpected thing happened. Fuller's two-year-old daughter stepped up to the grave and began to sing the only song that this little girl knew. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Clarence. Happy birthday to you. We have two funerals that we have to do between now and the end of June. And could you imagine if we ended the funeral by singing Happy Birthday? People would think that Stella and Bill have lost their mind. Happy birthday at a funeral, how strange and yet how absolutely appropriate that is. When a Christian dies, it's a birthday of sorts, because death is not an ending, but a beginning. So when we think of our dead, let us do it with a hopeful remembrance, with a hopeful memory, for an amazing future still awaits them and the rest of us as well. Let's pray together. Father, I want to thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, and I want to thank you for this message. Our God, you have spoken into my heart, whether you've touched anybody else here today or not. God, I want to thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. Thank you, our God, that you alone are the one worthy of our praise. Father, we ask that you would bless America today and bless our families in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me, please, as we sing our closing hymn? No number. You got to know this one by heart. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairie to the ocean white with foam,
God bless America, my home. as long as it doesn't to me. It's a nice way. Pray with me. Father, we just ask that you would dismiss us from this place, never from your presence. Our God, that your Holy Spirit would give us hope in our memory. Hope in our present. Hope in our future. Make your face to shine upon us today, Father. Bless all the families who paid such a price for our freedom. But above all, may we remember with a hopeful memory that death is not the end. We pray this in Christ's name, and all God's children said, amen. God bless you. Have a good day.